Okay, welcome back. And well, let's start by seeing if there are any questions. I didn't mention this, of course, but you can always, you know, I'll be here for 2 weeks, so you can ask questions all the time. But if there is something that you feel like could be shared with all your colleagues, you can ask it now. Okay, and of course, interrupt any time. Let me start then by sort of smoothly moving on to the first part of this course. But I will start by sort of reviewing and putting a little bit more in a concrete form what we have done so far. So we have studied N equal 1, D equal 4, rigid, smoothing. And we have seen that the two key players for the construction of our theories are a chiral superfield, phi, and the vector superfield, v, on which you can construct the strength. And we have seen that this v, then, since it has, so the expansion starts off in the Gersonino gauge, starts off with a gauge field plus the Gruino and all of these other things. So let me just write schematically plus lambda. Well, and we have seen that they all carry a Lie algebra index A. So we will start with a gauge group G, which could be anything, but really we will focus mostly in the case where the gauge group is the unitary group SUN. So this A will be the index in the adjoint representation of SUN. These chiral superfields will also carry a representation of this gauge group. So let's say we have we put an index I here, where I goes between, so this goes between 1 and the dimension of the group, of course, which is the same as the dimension of the adjoint representation, whereas this one will go from 1 to the dimension of the representation in which these fields transform. And we can think of, for any representation, we can think of the representation being generated by some traceless Hermitian matrices TA, obeying the computational relations of the algebra. Let me just check that I use the capital indices and not the lower. Yeah, I guess, well, yeah, I start off with the wrong indices. So let's try to have the same notation as in the. So these are the commutational relations of the Lie algebra. These T's will be the generators of, let's say, SUN or any gauge group in the particular representation R under which these fields transform. So TA.
So this one about the first term of the vector superfield. So I was thinking about the index structure of the first term.
Yes.
Like alpha. No, but the alpha, and then alpha dot. Is there a bar on the sigma, or is there not a bar?
Let me see now. Easy to check, then to look. So here there is a bar. Yeah, well, if you write it like this, there is no bar, you're right.
Okay.
The thing is that I had written it, that's correct. So very good.
Thank you.
Yes. All right, yeah. And so everything is actually correct, but there was a one half here. So this is actually correct. Thank you. Right, so the T's will be then considered will be matrices with indices ij for each a, okay? And so we have seen that the full structure of the Lagrangian then will be given by, so the action, if you wish, will be the integral over d4x. So there will be a piece that I will generically write like this, which is the Kähler potential with the gauge invariance properly taken care of. This will generate all the kinetic terms for the metal fields. So what do I mean by this, of course, is that if V, so if VA is a set of vector superfields, real vector superfields with the algebra indices, I can also equivalently describe it as a matrix V. So this V now will be a matrix, which is nothing but VA times TA. So this is what you do for the gluon as well. You can think of the gluons as a bunch of vectors with an index in the algebra, in the algebra, or as a matrix. No, this is the same thing. So this will be now a matrix. The exponential of a matrix is a matrix. And so if you want to put all the indices in, just for once, we will slowly wean ourselves away from using indices. The whole point about this notation is that once you know how the indices go, then there's a unique way to put them, and then you can actually simplify your life by not writing them, because they can only be put in one way. And this is the way they are put in this case. And of course, this is integrated over theta as well. So that's the kinetic piece for the chiral superfields. Then we saw that there was a kinetic piece for the vector superfields, which I write like this, plus complex conjugate. There is a 1 over g square, if you wish, or you can absorb the 1 over g square here. I'm being a little bit sloppy on where to put the Young-Mills coupling. I mean, this gauge group will have a coupling, g. G is the coupling constant. And let me be a little bit sloppy about it. You should put it here, really, G to G there. And then everything else will be normalized as you know and love from ordinary, from elementary gauge theories. Let's put it here. And then you have the piece with the superpotential, which is unchanged from what we saw this morning. So here I will have, so again, please notice that this W has nothing to do with this W. Even you try to use a different font. This is a fermion, that is an index, is the field strength of the vector superfield. This is a holomorphic function, no indices, of only the chiral superfield phi, plus complex conjugate as well. And now all I got to do is to make sure that this phi better be gauge invariant, obviously, right? So if I have, if phi transforms under a certain representation of the gauge group, then this object here as a function of this phi, of these complex numbers, will have to be invariant under the action of that group, okay? So this is our, this is the theory we will look at for the next few hours. So not just now, but also for a while, because this theory, and even with just with SUN, contains a lot of physics. In fact, we will even restrict ourselves, and I might as well do it now, let us restrict ourselves to the case where the representation is actually the fundamental representation of SUN. So just let's take the fundamental representation of SUN. Let me just do it just once more in generally, and then we will restrict to super QCD. Let me just do it in this case in all generality. These are, could be still anything, in fact could be a reducible representation of SUN. In other words, could be some, these phis could be some block, you know, this representation could be some block diagonal matrices, and this phi could be a set of fields transforming in different representations. So this is a generic notation that is valid for any gauge theory. So let's stick with that for just one more second. So then, for those of you who have done this calculation, you know the answer. For those of you who haven't, I do encourage you to do it. You just have to integrate out all the thetas. So pick out the proper pieces that are picked out by the theta integrals, and what you get the action of a you get the most general action of an n equal to 1 supersymmetric gauge theory. Now I will not write it down in its full glory. You can find it in all the references they give you. There will be, of course, all the kinetic terms for these guys, all the kinetic terms for the F and the green, we saw them today before lunch. You will get some terms with the W, which are actually important, and we will look at. But amongst all the things, you will get some scalar terms, some terms that involve only the scalars of the theory. These terms are particularly important, and let me write them down for you. So you will get a lot of stuff, plus, in fact, being an action, you get minus V. I guess V is a bad name. In fact, let me call it V like that. The potential of the scalar potential of this theory, okay? And let me tell you what this thing looks like. Now, to prove that, I would have to do a longish calculation with indices and so on, which I'm not going to do. And as I said, for those of you who haven't done it, this is really something that you should do in order to have full control of this thing. So, what the potential would look like, I just write it down. There will be something that we have seen before, d of a squared. This d, again, don't confuse it with a covariant derivative, it's not a d mu, it's a dA, as the auxiliary field that was present in the vector superfield, plus, here I decided for some reason to put the coupling constant, so let's put the coupling constant. These phis are the phis that are the scalars in the chiral superfield. I have t of a, r of j, phi of j, and again, I'm writing it down, and so times d of a. These terms we haven't seen yet this morning. This term arises, so let's see if anybody can guess, out of these three terms here, where that term there can possibly arise from.
The first term,
indeed. The first term, because, well, this guy does not have any dependence on V, and this guy does not have any dependence on phi, so better be this one. And it is. So this one was not there when we wrote the action for the pure chiral superfield, because there was no D. But now we have this term. Then we have something that we've seen before. Well, maybe we haven't, but now I have it down. No, we did, actually. We did see this term here, which is the F squared, that I remind you was also coming from here. It has to come from here. Why can it not come from here? Because W is holomorphic, and therefore there cannot be an F bar there. So this also comes from there. And then there are pieces from the superpotential that I write down. Plus, and bar one. And this is our superpotential in its full glory. Our potential in its full glory. And we call it off-shell, now I'll introduce a little bit of lingo, off-shell potential. Off-shell in this case means that this is how the potential looks like before you solve for the equations of motion of the auxiliary fields. So the point of this whole story is that the field D, which appears here and here, and the field F, which appears here, F bar here, and both of them here. These guys appear in the full Lagrangian, which I didn't write down, appear without derivatives. In fact, this is all there is. This is the only place where these auxiliary fields appear. There is no other Fs. Here there is no Fs and no Bs. Okay? But if you look at them, then you see, well, this is clearly a very trivial dependence, because it's just a quadratic dependence, and it has no derivatives in it. So I can just solve for the equation of motion. In other words, I can just minimize this with respect to D and F, find what D and F are, and put them back, and get the on-shell potential. So let's do that quick exercise. Now, the word on share and off share is somewhat abused, and it's essentially it means with or without using the equations of motion. Then what kind of equation of motion depends on the context. In this case, we mean the equation of motion for F and D. But in other cases, it's other equations of motion. It's all you have to know what you did, you have to know what you're doing, and then that's the letter. So now, of course, since we know that indices cannot contract, can contract only like this, we can just eliminate all these indices, really. What can they be? You can only write it in one way. The phi carries some index, and it's, well, we just, and it has to contract with the F. So we will write it like this. The index in the adjoint, I could also eliminate it, but that, I guess, would make life a little bit more difficult. So it is customary to keep the index 8. So we'll do that. So I have to solve for the equation of motion for D, which, being a trivial, this is the Euler-Lagrange equation for D, because there is no derivative, so this is really trivial. And this is the same as this. With B is that potential there, so my script B is a little, I don't know what to do. B, okay. So that thing there, I just have to minimize. And this means that, I hope I get the right sign, it means that D is equal to minus G, phi bar, dA, phi. Similarly, I minimize with respect to F. F, in fact, let me do it with respect to F bar. And when I do the derivative with respect to F bar, see, taking the derivative with respect to F bar picks out F and sets it equal to minus this. Right? I want to, it has to be, well, F plus this guy has to be equal to zero. So this means that F of I, which is equal to minus. Alright? Okay. Now you can take these and put them back. And what you get is the on-shell potential. Now you have to, please do this exercise, because there's always this magic of like the factor of two and so on. But this looks funny because it's like potential with a minus sign and so on. But this minus sign goes away once you solve and you put the thing on shell. And in fact, what you get is a positive quantity. You get the V. After imposing this, is equal to plus square. Okay, you can check that this is what happens when you put the solution. This is called the on shell potential. And clearly, the physics is the same. I mean, this is, you should, you know, whatever you, we have just eliminated some fields that have no dynamics, so we shouldn't worry too much about it. Just so to avoid confusion, sometimes this is also written as this. Which is clearly not the same as that. What you mean here, when you see it written like this, is because they mean that these guys are evaluated at the solution, so on shell. Okay, so this is the same as that if you replace D and F, obviously, with these two solutions, okay? So it's somewhat confusing to write it like this because the D, well, it's gone away, but I hope you understand what is meant. Anyway, the on-shell potential does depend only on the dynamical field, that is, the phi is coming from the chiral superfields. Okay? Now, is everybody happy with the notation so far? Okay? Right. So now we can start playing with this thing. And let us look at this potential. So if we want to, we will think now, to begin with, we will start talking about the classical theory. So we will think of this gauge theory as a classical field theory. And we will think of that as a first order approximation to the full theory. So let us think of the theory as classical. So we will think of this as classical. So in a classical theory, what is the first thing you do? Well, the first thing you do, you find the classical vacuum. What is the classical vacuum? The classical vacuum is the set of fields that minimizes the potential. Remember the Higgs potential, the Mexican hat? You take the classical the variation and you want to find the phi that minimizes the potential. So treating a gauge theory classically, the first thing you do, you look at the scalar potential and you try to minimize it. In supersymmetry, this is very easy to do because you immediately realize that the structure of the potential is really, it's rigidly fixed by supersymmetry. Essentially, it's up to an holomorphic function, you can't do anything. Once you fix the gauge group and the representations of the phis, this is fixed. You can give me a super potential, okay? But so up to an holomorphic function, this is completely determined. So these guys here are called, I should probably say this, this guy here are called the D terms. And these are called the F terms. Why? Because this one comes from D and the other one comes from F. Now, they are both positive. So we want to minimize the V. But we realize that this is a positive quantity, positive all zero, and this is a positive quantity, all zero. Which means that classically, the vacuum, the classical vacuum, will be characterized by V equal to zero. Which is true if and only if B is zero and F is zero. That is, if and only if phi bar d of a phi is zero and the W d phi is zero. These are called the F term, maybe these are called the D terms and the F terms condition. Okay? The bonus that you get is that if this is true, then, in fact, if and only if, we will discuss more in detail this, but if you can find a minimum such that, so first, maybe I didn't say it quite logically, so you realize that if this is a positive quantity, this is a positive quantity, so V must be a positive or zero quantity, right? So if you find a solution that is zero, that's going to be the minimum. We're happy with that, right? They cannot be negative, so if you find zero, it's going to be the minimum. So that's the vacuum. The bonus is that if it's the minimum, if the minimum is at zero, then V vanishes at zero, of course, and this means that SUSY is unbroken, at least classically. Now, we will come back to this, but the point is that we have seen the super algebra. So classically, we need, so we have seen that the Q's and the Q bars are proportional to the P, right? Now, for supersymmetry to be unbroken, I need the Q's and the Q bars to annihilate the vacuum and vice versa. And this really, if this algebra is to be obeyed, then P must be zero, including the zero component, the energy component. We will discuss the details and the subtlety later, but I hope you realize that classically, what you need here is for P to be zero, and therefore, the, in particular, the zero component of P, which would be the integral of over X of the potential, V, has to be zero. Okay, so V equal to zero, classically, is the same thing as saying the SUSY number. Okay, so these are the theories that will occupy us for a few hours. And the details of this, I want to leave them for the next, for a few hours. So, it turns out that already at the classical level, so this is a question that you can ask. So first of all, first good news, where are the spinners? They're gone. So we can study supersymmetry, in this case we can do a lot of things without worrying about spinners. Just looking at the minimum of this guy, so you get a lot of mileage and you don't have to worry about the sigma matrices and so on, which is good news. This is a question that you can ask a mathematician, of course. Well, you can ask a lot of things for a mathematician, but this is really a very, very well-defined question that you can ask a mathematician. Turns out, actually, they didn't need us to ask, because they knew that already. And let us, in fact, start with the definition. So it is interesting to study the space of solution of this object. So let's give it a name. So let us call the moduli space of this theory is a set, and here we will talk about the class, since we're talking about the classical theory, we'll talk about the classical modular space. Okay. The classical modular space is the set of phis, which are the only fields present. These are the complex fields. These are the complex fields, but now we think of them as constant, yeah, because it's a vacuum. We think of this. So this is really, these phis are nothing but complex numbers. Okay? It's the set of phis that solve this equation, the D term and the F term equation, up to an equivalence namely, we consider the same point if phi and, I don't know how to call it, because I call G the coupling constant, so let me call, I don't know, big G, phi, up to a gauge transformation, okay? Which in this case is a constant, actually, transformation, because these phis are constant. I could even put a zero here, just to make sure that we know that this is a constant solution. I don't want to start turning on derivatives or kinetic terms and so on. I want these things to be absolutely constant. The fermions, needless to say, have to be set to zero. So to minimize this thing classically, all I need to do is to find a bunch of complex numbers that satisfy these algebraic equations, no problem, up to this equivalence. Well, this G is a group action of on these constants, and this G is of course the gauge group that I'm considering. Okay. This is defined as the classical moduli space of the theory. Now, just sometimes people, just so that you don't get confused in the literature, sometimes people refer to the moduli space because this condition is much more interesting and intricate than this one. This is an holomorphic condition that you can take care of at the end. So the difficult part, not surprisingly, is to solve this one, because this one is a non-holomorphic condition. This one is an holomorphic condition, so it's easier to work with complex number. Here you have to work with the real number if you really want to solve it explicitly. So it's a bit difficult. So sometimes people refer to this as the classical modular space, and then they look at this separately and they talk about what happens if you turn on or turn off a superpotential. Let me just say that this is the classical modular space, and I just used, as a definition, I just used both of the conditions. So let's take a trivial example, just so that we know what's going on. So we might, yes, there was a question.
There are also the fermions in the action, right? And there are also interaction terms for fermions. In principle, they are also
right, very good, very good. So the action, so schematically, right? So the action is, there is an F square, F mu square. There is the lambdas. Then there is the phis. Then there is a term which actually, it will come back and bite us at some point, which is the Yukawa coupling. We didn't see this term, but these are the Yukawa coupling that comes from the superpotential. Then you have some funny Yukawa couplings involving lambda and psi, lambda psi and so on. And then you have, at the end of the day, you get this V here. Now, if you set A mu to zero, this goes away. This becomes the ordinary derivative slash. Oh, this is also the covariant derivative, of course. And so on. Now, if you set also the psi's and the phi's and the lambdas to zero, which is what you do in a gauge invariant, in a supersymmetric vacuum, you want this thing also gives zero. So all the Yukawa terms are zero. So all these guys go away. And the only thing that you're left with is to find the solutions to V. So the only thing that remains when you study the vacuum, this is, by the way, the same thing that you do in a non-supersymmetric theory, right? The classical vacuum, the only thing that matters are really the scalars. Not true, I mean, there could be some funny topological configurations, but let's not get carried away with that. So as long as topologically trivial configuration go, the only thing you have to look for is the minimum of the scalar. So let's take a trivial example. Is this a satisfactory? This is just ordinary field theory. There's no supersymmetry needed here. Take this, you know, what is the vacuum of the standard? What is the vacuum of the, how do you find the vacuum of the standard body classically? this picture you've seen, right? Why don't you worry about the rotor forks? Oh, that's a possible, classically. All right, so so that's the modular space. Let me just take a trivial example. Let's take a trivial example, a not so trivial example, and a highly non-trivial example. Trivial example. Let's take a case where we have just a Bezzomino model. Did I mention what a Bezzomino model was? Probably not. It's what we have seen before. Is Bezzomino, so Bez and Zomino are, of course, essentially the fathers, well, there is a lot, the history is a long story, but Bezzomino constructed an extremely interesting supersymmetric theory in four dimensions interacting that did not have a gauge symmetry at the beginning, and that is called the Bezzomino model. So the Bezzomino model is essentially a theory, it's a supersymmetric interacting theory with chiral fields on it. This is the theory we've seen before. This is the theory where we have this as our chiral potential plus y plus complex conjugate. This is the Bezzomino model. Okay? One thing that I didn't mention is that in order for this model to be normalizable when you write everything out in component, you can check, it's a nice exercise, that, well, W has to be at most cubic. It has to be at most cubic because remember that the potential contains a piece that goes like this. This was one piece in the potential. You know that in four dimensions, for a scalar potential to be normalizable, it has to be dimension four, it has to be at most quartic, right? We're happy with this. So for this to be quartic, it means that the derivative of W must be quadratic, because I'm squaring it. It means that W must be cubic. Okay? So this was at the beginning I asked the question, what is the W is a polynomial. Of what degree must W be so that V is normalizable? Answer, cubic, so that the derivative is quadratic and the square is quadratic. So this is the Bezzomino potential. This is the Bezzomino model. Let me take then a trivial example. So this model particularly has no problem with D terms. There are no D terms because there is no gauge. So the only thing you want to do to solve for that model is to find solution. So the only thing you need to check for this thing to be a vacuum is that dw d phi is equal to zero. So here I wrote capital phi because I try to think of capital phi when it's a superfield and little phi when it is the lowest scalar component of the superfield. You will soon realize that you can just use the same letter because if you know what you're doing, clearly, this must be a super field because I'm integrating a theta, theta, but here it doesn't really matter because if it works for one, it works for the other. So it's a. So we want to minimize this W. So let's take a simple example. Consider W to be some constant times phi 1 square phi 2. Okay? So this is a trivial example. So I want you to take 30 seconds. And try to figure out what the modular space of this theory is. After 30 seconds, I'll give you the answer. There are two fields, phi 1 and phi 2. So I have to solve then this for both phi 1 and phi 2. And two fields, I have to do it for both. This one, so the first one gives me lambda phi 1 phi 2. The second gives me lambda phi 1 squared. This means that phi 1 must be 0. But this also means that phi 2 can be anything. So any phi 2 will solve the equations of motion for this particular superpotential. Rather trivial. There's no real interesting stuff there. But just as an example, So the moduli space of this very simple model is simply the complex plane, and is parameterized by all the possible complex values that phi 2 can take. Okay? Now let's take a little bit, a slightly more less trivial model, which is actually kind of interesting. Let's take super QED. So, what is super QED? Well, it's QED, super symmetrized. Now, QED is a theory of a U1 gauge field, the photon, and a Dirac fermion, right? The electron. There's both left-handed and right-handed field. Now, if I want to write, so before I do super QED, I may want to do QED. QED is as a photon, of course, and then you have a Dirac fermion, which is the electron, say, which I could write as a piece, a left-handed piece, and a right-handed piece, right? And this guy has charge equal, Q equal to minus 1, right? In the sense that, you know, when I gauge it, I pick up a phase. So it is invariant under e to the minus I alpha something, okay? So this is QED. Now, and QED typically is written in terms of one right-handed and one left-handed field, because being parity invariant, this is a convenient, using Dirac notation is convenient. In supersymmetry, it's much more convenient to make an absolutely one-to-one change of description, and never talk. A tip for supersymmetry is never talk, never use. Maybe I shouldn't say this. Use only a left-handed field. It's the same thing, but in other words, because remember that phi, which we would like to use as, so phi will be a complex chiral field. Will start out with a complex scalar field, and then there will be some theta something here, which say I want to associate it with the left-handed electron. Let's say this is EL. So EL is a bile, left-handed bile. Okay? Plus its friend is F term, okay? FL or something. But then, I also want a field for this guy. It's actually much more convenient. Instead of using ER, it's more convenient to introduce a new left-handed field. Let's call it E tilde, say, right? Which is the charge conjugate of this thing, which can be written by I sigma 2 E right star. You will remember, hopefully, that this, if this transforms in the right, if this transforms in the right-handed representation of the Lorentz group, this transforms in the left-handed representation of the Lorentz group, and use this to construct a new chiral superfield. It's called phi tilde, equal to phi plus root of 2 theta E tilde phi tilde plus theta square F tilde. Okay? So actually, let me drop this L. So super QED is written in terms of two chiral superfields, a phi and a phi tilde. Okay? Now, what are the charges of these fields? You got to just be a little bit careful, because you would like to say, of course, the electron is charged minus 1, right? But can you see a problem there? Or that reactor? Not a problem, it's not a feature. Now, phi has charge minus 1, as it did, indeed, this E was the left-handed fermion, which is, of course, has charge minus 1. But phi tilde has now charge plus 1. Because I took the complex conjugate here, so if E right must be of the same charge as E left, because they have to fit into a Dirac spinor. You can only fit stuff into a Dirac spinor if they transform in the same representation of the gauge group. So these two guys must always have the same charge. But if I then go from the right-handed to the left-handed notation, I have to take a charge, complex conjugate, and this means that the new superfield, phi tilde, transforms with a charge plus 1, okay? So these are the fields of super QED. So these are the fields of super QED. So super QED, the scalar fields will obey this thing. Okay? Let's make our life easy, and let's think that there is no superpotential. The superpotential in general would be an holomorphic combination of these two guys that has to be Gauge invariant. What can it be? Well, we'll see in a second. It's not hard to guess, right? It has to be a polynomial of these guys that has to be neutral under charge. And remember, charge is add, so you know, I want it. But let's say that this is zero. Even if this is zero, we still have the D terms. So let us look at super QED with D terms. So let's look at the D terms for this object. Again, let me try to give you 30 seconds to see if you can work out the D terms by yourself, and then I write them down. Remember, I think you have them on your notes, remember what the D terms are. Now think that the generators, this T of A that I have, are now nothing but the charges. Okay? In fact, I guess I should probably put a plus and a minus. It doesn't matter, eh? I guess, usually, doesn't matter. So, well, let's keep it consistent with that. So the D-term would be just a one real function of phi and phi tilde. That looks like this. Why? Well, because this is the charge of, well, it's minus this, right?
Oh, okay.
Sorry, what?
We had
the G as a coupling constant. Or let me set it to 1. If you want, you can put it and it's here. But whatever, you know, yeah, this coupling constant will always follow for the right, but unless it's zero, which in which case makes the theory trivial, then you want this to be zero anyway. So this doesn't really matter. Right? So now we want to find the moduli space for this theory. Okay? So the first thing we say then is that, well, we need phi to be the same as phi theory. Okay? So first of all, what is the set? So the game is that we want to find what is called the classical moduli space, script M with little CL. As some variety, some manifold, something embedded in what? In 2C squared. Because I have two scalar fields. Each of them is a complex number. And I want to find that thing. Okay? So, C squared has four, of course, has four real coordinates. Two are the real and imaginary part of phi, and two are the real and imaginary part of phi tilde. Okay, we can start getting rid of some of them. So first of all, well, this thing means that so the D-term solution, the D-term condition, implies obviously that this must be equal to that. This means that phi tilde can be almost written in terms of phi. It's equal to phi up to a phase, which I called alpha. And unfortunately, I actually solved for phi as a function of phi tilde, so let me stick with my notes. All right? So, however, this phase is also irrelevant as far as the moduli space is concerned, because remember that we want to identify solutions that are gauge equivalent. So I can always, so the gauge transformation always rotate phi to e to the I. Now, I think I'm afraid that at some point this has become plus and this has become minus. I hope you realize that there is absolutely no difference there. It's so I can always rotate. So if the charge is plus, I can always rotate this phi by a phase gamma and this phi tilde by the same phase minus gamma. Right? And I have to consider this and this set of fields and this set of fields as equivalent when I write down the moduli space. I should not count them. So this phase must be gotten rid of. This I can easily do because I can look at the So let us take the solution to the D-term equation. This is the most general solution to the D-term equation without worrying about the edging variance. Let us check what the equivalent solutions are. Well, I just put the gammas there, and what I get, of course, is that an equivalent solution would be e to the I gamma phi equal to e to the I alpha minus gamma phi tilde, which is the same as saying that. So, and gamma should be irrelevant, which means that I can choose gamma to be equal to alpha over 2, such that a representative solution is equal to, is given by phi equal to phi tilde. In other words, this alpha phase is completely irrelevant. This gauge is a gauge-dependent phase. And I can get rid of it. Okay? So if I know phi tilde, I know phi. So basically the modular space is certainly not C squared, but is only C, because I only need to know one field, and the other one would be determined by the D-term equations and gauge invariance. If you're really fussy, there is actually a little subtle point, which you might as well mention, although we won't dwell on it now, is the fact that I could also have chosen, you see, gamma goes between zero, so alpha goes between 0 and 2 pi. It's a phase. Gamma also goes between 0 and 2 pi. But then I could have chosen this, or I could have also chosen this. Because if alpha goes between 0 and 2 pi, alpha divided by 2 goes between 0 and pi. So I could have two gammas that solve this equation, this one and this one. They're both good choices. In the other case, I get minus phi equal to minus phi tilde, which surely is the same as this. So what I'm saying is that it is true that the modular space, the classical modular space, is essentially given by the values of phi, a complex belonging to the complex number, phi tilde being solved by this. But strictly speaking, you still have a discrete invariance like this, okay? So strictly speaking, the modular space is C divided by Z2, which is a cone. So it's the same, topologically it's the same as the complex plane. Instead of being this, I just eliminate the lower plane and I wrap this thing up like a tortilla chips or whatever, like a cone. Okay, topologically it's still a plane, but metrically it's not. So this guy will have a metric singularity here. We will not go into that now, but just for precision. So by now you get a little bit scared because you see that already QED, which should be the easiest, it is the easiest of the gauge theories, it's already kind of tricky to find the modular space. And remember that we need the modular space because that's a space of vacuum. Well, first of all, we have learned an important lesson. We have learned that in a gauge theory with no superpotential, even in the simplest one, there will always be a continuum of vacuum. So you're not just in the Higgs case, well, this is a little fun, but so you're going to get, so there is not going to be just one vacuum, but there is not going to be a whole moduli of vacuum, parameterized in this case by a complex number. Okay, this is a generic property of gauge theories, namely the existence of flat direction. That is, deformations, non-gauge equivalent deformations, so different vacuum, different solution of the classical equations of motion that still keep the vacuum, the potential to zero. Okay, we've gotten rid of the gauge equivalent. So truly, any point here defines a different vacuum of the theory, and there's an infinite number of them. Something that does not happen in ordinary gauge theories. And it must happen in supersymmetric gauge theory because of the structure of the D-terms. Okay? So this is a lesson that we learned. The other lesson is that it's a bit scary to solve for the D-terms. That's it. But then there is a theorem to the rescue. And the difficulty is always in the D-terms. So the F-terms are just, you just want to minimize that. It's not that bad. But for D-terms, it's a bit tricky. But luckily, there is a nice theorem coming to the rescue. The next theorem says that the space, so this is an important theorem, that for which I have a proof, but given the fact that I want to, I don't want to spend too much time on it. So I have the proof, and I will, but I will skip it. And for those of you who are interested, we can go through it during the break that we start, you know, whenever. Okay, but we'll take a break in a few minutes. But just let me state the theorem, and then after that, we go. We'll take a break. So, theorem. The space of solutions to the D-term equation. Now we consider an arbitrary gauge group up to gauge transformation. This is the moduli space if you consider a theory with no superpotential. Theory with no superpotential was the space of solution to D equal to zero after gauge transformation. So this is the modular space if you ignore the superpotential. That space, which is the one that is difficult to find in a sense, is parameterized by all the independent holomorphic gauge invariant monomials, really, of monomials. If they're polynomials, they're clearly dependent. So monomials in phi. So remember now, phi is a set of complex fields. In QED, we have two. In a general supersymmetric gauge theory, we will have a certain number depending on the representation. So phi would be a bunch of complex numbers. If you can construct all the independent, independent simply means algebraically independent. So it means that if you take the product, you make some gauge invariant objects. Usually you get an overcomplete basis because by taking the product of two and using some group theory mumbo jumbo, you may generate some other stuff, which you already there. So if you manage to get a set of independent gauge invariant potential, this is your modular space. This is a wonderful theorem because it takes you from the real domain to the complex domain. And sure enough, it's much easier to do it like this. For instance, in QED, we had a field phi of charge plus one and a field phi tilde of charge minus one. And I ask you, what are all the holomorphic, so I'm not allowed to use complex conjugation, gauge invariant, that is charge zero, independent objects that I can construct. I can only construct this one. Let's call it M. This is a field, this is a complex field, it's chargeless, no charge, because it's plus one minus one. It's holomorphic, and it parameterized by modular space. And you can even put this minus sign into its place by working out the Kernel potential, but let's not worry about that. So this is it. So I could not write this, of course, this, well, this is the complex conjugate, this is gauge invariant. But this ain't good. This does not obey the theorem. I'm not proving the theorem, I'm just saying some application. This is gauge invariant, but not holomorphic, so no good. This is holomorphic, but not gauge invariant, so no good. This guy is is holomorphic and gauge invariant, but not independent, obviously, because this is equal to M squared. So this is all you got. So we've proven that this is a one-line proof of a rather complicated thing with phases and so on. So I will skip the proof. The proof is in my notes. You're welcome to read it, ask me or whatever. It's a nice proof, only for the U1 group. But I have to move on because I'm going a little bit slowly. Let's take a break. So, welcome back. There have been a lot of complaints because I forgot to mention the Phaianioplos terms. Many people are thinking, what about the Phaianioplos terms? They will be mentioned. So first of all, what are the Phaianioplos terms? I should have mentioned the theory that I wrote down was somewhere here, I guess. As I claimed, it was the most general gauge theory. It's true up to a little thing that I forgot to mention, is the fact that if you have a U1 gauge group, a U1 factor, you can actually add to the whole thing an extra piece, which is plus some constant times d, d being the U1, the auxiliary field of the U1. Okay. This you can add to the Lagrangian that you have, and it's still supersymmetric because the variation, the supersymmetric variation of D, is a total derivative. So when you integrate over d4x, this is invariant under supersymmetry. You can also write it in superspace by writing it like this. So I was thinking also, and this would be then psi times V. V, no indices, works only for U1, because for U1, V, the adjoint representation of U1 is the trivial. Up to the face to the left and to the right, you get zero. So V is not charged. So certainly V is gauge invariant. It's not gauge invariant if you put an A here, because, well, it's not gauge invariant. But if you don't, so for the U1 is fine. And these thetas take care of all the thetas that follow, that multiply D inside V. And so at the end of the day, this would be the very sort of the full Lagrangian. For every U1 field, you can have this. It will come back. Right now, it's of interest for many reasons, but not for the kind of reasons that, for the kind of theories that I'm going to discuss now, because since it only works for U1, the U1 theories are, of course, infrared trivial. They are free in infrared. They become less and less coupled because the beta function is positive. So since I'm interested now to study the interesting dynamics, strong coupling dynamics of supersymmetric gauge theories, I will not consider U1 groups. They're not the interesting one. So for now, we will not consider the U1 groups, and we will not consider the Phaianioplos. It will come back when we talk about the supersymmetry breaking, because it is a nice one of the earliest examples of classical three-level supersymmetry breaking. We will see that. Right. So, any more questions about what we did so far? So let's move on now, still classically. Let's now we looked at classical QED. Now let's look at what's going to be the theory that will occupy us for the next, well, this lecture and certainly the next two, maybe three, 2 minutes. Not classic, we will talk about super QCD, but we'll start with classical super QED. CD. So we will generalize the abelian case to the case where the gauge group is now a non-abelian group, and we will think about SUN for eccentricity. You can do it for any group, it's sort of fun. And what are the fields, what are the vector fields? So the vector fields, of course, would be V of A, which is the usual one, and A goes from 1 to n c squared minus 1. Which is the dimension of the adjoint representation. We will also have some chiral superfields. Now, remember QCD. QCD is a theory of quarks and gluons. The quarks are Dirac after spontaneous symmetry breaking. In the actual QCD Lagrangian, forget the standard model, in the actual QCD Lagrangian, the quarks have both the left-handed and the right-handed component. So we will have to treat them exactly as we did for the electron. And instead of writing the quarks as right-handed and left-handed, we will introduce two sets of chiral superfields, both left-handed and both independent from each other, that we will call Q and Q tilde, following the literature of the 90s. I already said most of the things that we will see here is due to the work of Seidel and collaborators. There's lots of other people that have also contributed. The notation is basically standard. It's hard to come up with anything new to say with it. So these are the Q and the Q tilde. So what are these guys? So they are chiral superfields. Let's put some indices. Alright? Let's put some indices. Let's say, okay, they are in the fundamental representation. That means that that means that Q will have a color index C in the fundamental, and Q tilde will have a color index C as well. I put one downstairs and one upstairs because as a color, as a symmetry of SUN, this field transforms into fundamental representation. If I put a box here, do you know what that means? So it's the fundamental representation of SUN, which means it's generated by the generalized Gell-Mann matrices. You know, start SU2 as the Pauli matrices, SU3 as the Gell-Mann matrices, and then they stop giving them names because by then everybody had learned the trick. So, but these are the sort of your emission traceless NC squared minus 1 matrices that generate the fundamental representation of SUN. And this guy transforms under the anti-fundamental. Okay? So, if I have my generators, TA, suppose that these are my generators of the fundamental. To get the generators of the anti-fundamental, I have to take these guys, conjugate them, but then I don't quite get this representation because these guys don't obey this commutation relation because there is an I here. So these are, you know, it doesn't really work. If I take the complex conjugate of this, I don't get this. But I can fix that very easily by putting a minus here. So if I have, these are the fundamental generators and these are the anti-fundamental generators, okay? And what I mean is that as a gauge symmetry, then the variation of Q, QC, would be equal to some constant T of A, alpha of A, T of A, C, C prime, Q of C prime, and similarly that of Q tilde C will be equal to alpha of A, T tilde A, Q tilde, C prime, C. Hope I got it right. And alpha, of course, are the parameters parameterizing the particular SUN transformation. This is what I would call NF. So, if there is one set of fields like this, and this is one set of fields like this, this is what I would call the NF number framework equal to 1. Why? Because inside of this, so we will not look too much at V, but V essentially is, remember, let me be sloppy here. It has the gluon, and it has the, well, let's just forget the tilde. It has the gluon, and it has the gluino, and it has the auxiliary field. Okay, what about Q? Q will have a scalar field for any complex, Q will have a scalar field transformed in the fundamental representation, plus, okay, let me put the psi here, plus, of course, theta squared, F. All of these guys transforming in the fundamental representation of the gauge group. This is the left, this will be the left-handed. Quark. And this would be the squark associated to S because of the supersymmetric part or the scalar part according to taste, both the beginning and the S, of the quark. And then I would introduce Q tilde, which is a completely independent field, Q tilde root of 2 theta psi tilde, and this is also a quark, and it's the charge conjugate of the right-handed quark. So a quark is a Dirac field, which I can write in terms of Wien fermions, two Wien fermions. And then I get, this comprises one flavor, because one flavor of QCD, say the up quark, is both this guy and this guy. So this is the NF equal to 1. What if I want to consider the NF equal to whatever? Well, that's very easy. For any NF, I can just put a flavor in this. So this could be the up, the down, the strange, the charm, and so on. Oh, no masses here. Eh? So I'm not thinking phenomenology. I'm just trying to sort of trigger your intuition. There is no, don't think of this as actually them. Although, well, they would be in the phenomenological Lagrange of the FNSSM, they would be described exactly in the same field. But the point is, there is an extra index F that parameterize now the flavors from 1 to NF. Okay? Now, I would like to start by studying the modular space, the classical modular space of this theory in the case where there is no superpotential. So let's set the superpotential to zero. You can actually immediately think that the options for the superpotential, if you want to stick with the normalizable theories, are pretty limited. In fact, you can only have a mass term. But let's not even worry about that now. Let's suppose there is no superpotential. Let's write the D terms. What are the D terms? We would like to solve. So I would like to solve it. I won't do the whole sort of song and dance, but I want to give you an intuition of how it works. Because, and at the end of the day, once we have a clear example, so let me tell you what we'll do. We're going to look at the modular space of the classical theory. Okay, that's the first thing you do. We've learned from the 90s that the first thing you do, you look at the classical theory, which is you know, treatable in terms of algebra, like basic algebra. And then you have to be a little bit clever, well, I'll follow the clever people that have done it, and see how you can introduce quantum corrections to that. So right now we look at the classical theory, that is, we want to find a solution to the set of determinant equation, which I write down without further ado. They are Q dagger T. Now I think, just to confuse you, I started putting capital A's for the, in my notes at least, for the indices in the adjoint. So because now there will be a lot of indices and the flavor will be a little bit of a mess. So now all of these things, the adjoint indices from now on will be capitalized. So think of all of these as capital A's. At least that's what's in my notes. I could try to sort of translate it on the fly, but I think I better not do that. Well, what are the D terms? These are the D terms. Because these are the D terms. That's what the D terms look like. This is up to the G, forget the coupling constant and so on. I mean, this has to be zero if I want this to be a solution. So for every field in every representation, I will have to add up the D terms. So there were two. In this sense, the representation that we had at the beginning is reducible because it contains of fields in the fundamental and contains fields both in the fundamental and the antifundamental. And at the end of the day, if you spell it out, this is what it looks like. These are the D terms. Now, here is completely index free. Let's play a little game and try to put the indices here, for instance, just to make sure that we know what's going on. Because Q has both, and then we won't do this much anymore. Q has both a flavor index and a color index. Right? Now, this is a color. This is the generator of color as U and C. So it will have, it's in the fundamental. So it will have an index C and an index C prime, which of course contracts with this. How about F? Well, F contracts like this. This is the same F. Repeated indices, of course, are sum. This is the same F, meaning that this is really the sum of NF independent D terms, one for the up quark, one for the down quark, one for the sun. You understand? And the same thing here, right? In fact, we can do it even better because now we know what this thing here is. This is minus T A star, which actually is the same as minus T A transpose, because T A's are an emission. So it's more convenient to write it like this. And since it's transpose, I can play a little bit with the indices, and I claim that this whole thing can be written as T A. In fact, let me write it in its full glory. T A C C prime, of course, the C and C prime, let's put it like this so I get the same indices here, times. This is the thing that I had before. I'm just doing this once so that then I have a minus sign, because there's a minus sign here, and then here I have a transpose. That means that I have to flip the Q and the Q dagger. I want this to be zero. In other words, I can think of the Q's now. The Q's and the Q daggers are now thought of as complex matrices. This one is thought of as NC times NF matrix. And this one is thought of as an NF times NC. And if I, with this matrix notation, you can write this in matrix notation as well. This is row by column multiplication. Okay? And this is a trace. So this is matrix multiplication, trace. Okay? Something like that. Yeah. Now, right. So this one can actually be written in an even simpler way. Now remember that, these are all the Hermitian traceless matrix of SUN. And my claim is that, well, the details say that whatever this thing is, it has to be orthogonal, it has to be traced zero, if I trace it with all the TAs. But there's only one matrix that, if traced with all the TAs, is zero, namely the identity itself. So this equation here means that this guy must be proportional to the identity in color space. Right? The only matrix that is orthogonal to, when traced, orthogonal to all the T's is the identity matrix. But if it is, so let's put even let's say that this is equal to some number, some normalization times this. How do I fix this normalization? Well, I take the trace over color space, of course. If I sum now, if I forget this, and I say that this is equal to that, to get the normalization, I have to trace over a column. And what I get is then that the equivalent way of writing the D terms is now everything in matrix notation. Now let's see if you got the idea. Matrix notation is this. Statement, this is the mathematical statement of the words that I just said. Well, n is fixed to be 1 over nc because if I trace now this is the trace of this object. Now this is an nc times nc matrix. This is an nc times nc matrix. And this is the trace of an nc because the f's have already taken care of themselves. Okay? So it's a compact notation that takes a little bit of time to get used to, but then once you get used to it, it's absolutely straightforward to do anything here. It's just matrices. Let's just play with the case where an f is equal to 1. And let's see how we can write down more explicitly the classical modular space. So when an f is equal to 1, what I told you is that q is now a column vector with a bunch of complex entries, and c of them, and q tilde will be thought of as a row vector with a bunch of complex entries, and c of them. Okay? I want to find, given these guys, I want to find the solution to this. Looks tough, because it's, there should be a dagger to the right. It has to be the trace of this guy. Now, it looks difficult. But remember, first of all, that we are interested in classifying only the gauge invariant solutions. So I can use SUNC. Suppose I found a solution. Suppose I have a bunch of complex numbers here and here. That's solved for the D terms. Okay, suppose I have that. I can find an equivalent solution. Remember, I want to get rid of the equivalent solutions. Right? So I can find an equivalent solution by rotating Q with the SUNC matrix. I can always, so if Q and Q tilde are solution, I can always rotate Q to be A 0, 0, 0. By an NC matrix, just like you can take a real vector and rotate it to point along the z-axis. Right? I cannot, there and that, because I cannot use gauge invariance again, because Q tilde, of course, could be anything. I cannot say that then Q tilde is also like that. I cannot take Q. Oh. So Q tilde is still a mess. Let's call this mess B1, Bn. See, right? All right. So, and now we have to, so this, now we have to find the b's, well, we have to find these values such that the d terms are satisfied. But now, of course, this is much simplified. This, the d term equations are much simplified. And if you put this solution, which is gauge equivalent to any, to the most arbitrary one, you will get that Q dagger is a very trivial matrix, which has only one zero non-zero component, and everybody else is zero. Q tilde dagger, Q tilde is a mess, which is the, but is a lot of one, but is a complicated matrix which you obtain by taking this dagger and so on. So you get B1 squared, on the diagonal you get B1 squared, B2 squared absolute value, and then here you get something like B bar I Bj, and B bar J B I, for I different from J. This is what you get if you take Q dagger tilde Q tilde, of course. You happy? And this has to be equal to 1 over NC times the trace of this mess, which is nothing but, of course, A squared minus B1 squared minus bn squared times the, I wish I didn't spend too much space on that, but times the identity matrix, which is this one here. All right. I like to be clear, that's one of my courses, I always like to be. So, but I hope you understand the notation. This is the identity matrix. You got, you with me? Good. So, oh, then, all right, look. This is the identity matrix. That means that this has zeros all over the off-diagonal. Off-diagonal, this is zero. Off-diagonal, this is zero. And then this must be zero off-diagonal. This means that can only be one B that is non-zero, because if there were two Bs that are non-zero, so if two of the Bs, any two of the Bs were non-zero, then there would be some off-diagonal piece here that is non-zero. That can't be, because it would not solve the D-term equation, right? Right? So there must be only one B that is non-zero. And then a minute of thought immediately shows you that that B must be B1. Because otherwise even the diagonals would not work out. Remember that this has to be a constant times all the ones here. But so if there is only one B, so this means that this must be zero. And if this is zero, that means that A must cancel with something, and that something is B1. In other words, a minute of thought shows you that the only condition is that B1 is equal to A1, and all the other Bs are zero. All right? This for the absolute value, but you can actually even get the phase is right, because you can still use an extra U1 thing. So in fact, A1 and B1 are the same in this case. Okay? So, what I have argued here is that in the case of an F equal to 1, it seems like, if we haven't done anything wrong, the modular space is basically, see, this is a little bit of a little version of QED embedded in the first component here. Right? So, the modular space is C. Right? So what I have derived the hard way is the fact that the classical modular space is C. It's a complex, it's a plane, right? Now, of course, there is this issue with the metric singularities that let me not discuss that. Topologically, it is topologically equivalent to one copy of the complex plane. Now, we could have gotten this without doing all of this work by observing that the only gauge invariant, holomorphic, independent, monomial that I can construct with these two guys is M equal to Q tilde Q. Q tilde Q is a scalar, it's one component because Q tilde and Q are sort of like this. And so I get a point, I get a complex number. So I have one scalar field that parameterizes my modular space. Again, there are flat directions, classically. Any value of M parameterizes an independent vacuum, because this is gauge invariant. So gauge invariant, gauge transformation will leave M alone. So 1M is a gauge invariant parameterization of the vacuum. Different M's are gauge inequivalent. So there will be different vacuums. So again, there is a whole set of gauge invariant vacuums. So we will now quickly look at does it make any sense? I mean, so suppose there's, okay, let's do some Goldstone boson counting here. That's another thing that you should do to make sure that you found everything right. So I claim that the modular space is parameterized by one complex field, right? Does this make sense? Well, so I have seen that Q, I have argued that Q is this, and that Q tilde is this. Okay? Now, this means that if A is non-zero, which is certainly the generic case, if A is non-zero, the gauge symmetry SUNC is broken to what? This is the same as this. Just look at this guy. If I give a vacuum expectation value to the first component of a field, but keep all the others to zero, this clearly does not leave all the matrices of SUNC invariant, but it preserves a certain subgroup. What is that subgroup? One. Good. So how many Goldstone bosons do I have? The Goldstone bosons are the number, well, zero because it's six, but how many would be Goldstone bosons do I have? It's the number of broken generators. So the number of would be Goldstone bosons is the number of broken generators, which is the dimension of SUN minus the dimension of SUN minus one, which is equal to, look at that, it's 2n c minus 1. Okay? Now, how many, all right, so all of these guys will be eaten up by the gauge fields. So every vector field eats up a chiral field in the Higgs mechanism, in the supersymmetric case. So how many fields did I have to start with? I had, how many complex fields did I have? I have NC plus NC. So I started with 2NC fields. And 2NC minus 1 are eaten. By the Higgs mechanism, so they're not really Goldstone bosons, they're eaten. And there's one left. That one left is the massless chiral field that parameterizes the modular space, and it's indeed M equal to Q tilde. Okay? This always works. So, now, so the game of this and the final, so I will try to finish the classical theory, which I think would be pretty good going if I manage, which I probably will. We have 15 minutes. So I now want to generalize this. So I want to finish the classical theory, meaning, so now we have seen, so the result we have is that supersymmetric QCD, the SUN gauge group, and NF equal to 1 has, well, the modular space, the classical modular space, and we're doing classical here, as essentially is parameterized by by this q tilde q. It's a complex number. Okay. Now I want to see what happens for I and f. What happens for an f larger than 1. So let's go through the all the possible scenarios. So let us look at the case where an f is still. By the way, I didn't look at an f equal to 0, that is pure super QCD. So that's a very interesting theory. But it's a little bit outside of this kind of philosophy, because it doesn't have any scalars. So, well, there are no D terms, there are no F terms. So it's the only supersymmetric theory that has no scalars. Is n equal 1 pure young Mills? It's the only theory, the only gauge theory that has no scalars in it. So your handle on the moduli space is basically not there. There is no moduli space. And classically, I mean, then so you have to involve this theory is also understood to some extent, very interesting theory, but you have to take a whole different approach. So we start out with nf equal to 1, which gives us a handle, which gives us some complex fields to play with. Now we generalize now for nf larger than 1, but still less than nc. We will see in a minute why that is the case. Now, if nf is less than nc, we still write our fields as we did before. Now, we'll not do the whole song and dance, but let me start with q. So in general, q will be a mess. Will be a set of nf and then c. I will not do the whole thing. This you can read up in the literature, but it's not terribly important. I just want to make a consistency check. This is our q, and q tilde is the opposite. Now, remember what we did when we had 1. When we had 1, we started rotating. We used the sunc by saying that I can only, if this is a solution to the D-term equation, then I can find the gauge equivalent solution by putting an A here and putting zeros all over the place. Right? Now I have broken the gauge loop from SUNC to SUNC minus 1. But I can still use SUNC minus 1 then to put this to be an A2 and zeros all over the place. This in principle is not yet fixed, because I cannot rotate this. Right? I hope you understand what I'm doing. I'm assuming that there is such a solution. I'm using NC, SUNC to put the first row like that. Once I put the first row like that, if I don't want to mess up the first row again, then I have to forget this one, which means that here there can be anything. But I can still, now this is all zero, so this of course leaves SUNC minus 1 invariant, so I can use that invariance to rotate this one to 1. Place, okay, and so on. And because nf is less than nc, I finish the diagonal before I finish the matrix. So there are some zeros here. In other words, there is a, this thing is divided into nf nc minus nf pieces like this. And then there's an extra piece, nf. Okay. Now I will not do the whole story, but I claim that in fact the solution, you can play with this, it's in my notes, it's in all notes of any lecture on supersymmetric gauge theory. This is just a very first step to the solution of the whole D-term equation, but the bottom line is that you can get basically that q and q tilde have essentially the same form, and q, after you solve for the D-term equation, essentially is you can set all of these guys to zero and everything here to zero. This would be this is what happens. But this you have to play with this algebraic equation if you want, but we don't have to do that. Let's see, let's try to guess. First of all, and q tilde is the same structure. So basically, here I'm saying that I am breaking the theory from SUNC down to SU and C minus NF. Remember, before NF was equal to 1, so now it's SUNC and SUNC minus NF. Right? How many Goldstone bosons do I have? I have a bunch of Goldstone bosons, which is NC squared minus 1 minus and C minus NF squared minus 1, which you can simplify yourself. I will not do that. So how many fields, so the fields left over, what are they? They are the total number of fields. What is the total number of fields? Is the number of fields in Q plus the number of fields in Q tilde. The number of fields in Q is NF times NC. Okay? So the total number of fields is twice NF times NC. This is the dimension of the matrices Q and Q tilde. I put twice because I have to sum over that. Minus the number of would be Gaussian bosons, which is this number here. And if you do the algebra, you find that this thing is an F squared. At least it checks with an F equal to 1, because when an F was equal to 1, we had one field. Now, this also works for an F larger than 1. As long as NC is less than 1, as long as an F is less than NC, this still works. And what could these fields be? Well, what can they be? It is nothing but the generalization of the M that we had before, but now, summing over C, of course, but now I have the flavor index, F and F prime. So it's a meson, it's called a meson field, it's a meson because it's a bilinear in the original fields, with indices F and F prime. Each of these guys goes between 1 and an F. The common is summed up, so this is gauge invariant. How many of them are there? Well, they're exactly an F squared. So this is the moduli space for an F, less than NC. Okay? So in fact, I can just combine this into that and say that the classical moduli space for all of these things, the classical modular space is parameterized by a matrix, an NF times NF complex matrix, belonging to C to the NF square. Okay? Does this work for an F larger than NC? Well, it mustn't, because otherwise I would have told you that difference. Right? But what can go wrong for an F? Right? What goes wrong when an F is equal or larger than NC? Well, first of all, you can check that this Gaussian boson counting doesn't work. In fact, do it that way. Just do the counting. So when an F is larger than NC, we know that whatever we do, SUNC is completely broken. Because Q, you know, will always be a diagonal matrix. You can always rotate this to zero, but this guy generically will not be zero. So generically, for the generic position of the moduli space, you could say that this is completely broken. There is nothing, there is no subgroup of NC that leaves an NC times NC or larger matrix diagonal. If NC is even bigger, then I even stop. I ran out before, so, if, you know, I would run out. Yeah, something like that. So it's a mess. Of course, then solving for the detailed equation, you can only get them to the diagonal, but it doesn't matter. The point is that if I have too many flavors, and if I give to all of them an arbitrary bet, I would break the whole symmetry, right? So then you can play with this, and you realize that it doesn't work anymore. What does it mean? Because, I mean, the counting of the Gaussian boson has to work. What does it mean? It means that we forgot some fields. In other words, it means that for an F larger or equal to NC, there are some extra fields, not the mesons, that are still present, that and they're gauge invariant, and they parameterize my moduli space. Right, so what are they? They're very easy to find. They're called the baryons. So let's take the case when an F is equal to NC. F equal to NC, let me call it N, because sometimes it's NF, sometimes it's NC. Let's say that this is a case where we have. Now, certainly these guys are independent fields. Right? those are the ones that I wrote before, only I wrote them, of course, with the, so my convention is this, so let me keep the convention fixed. So these guys are certainly there. These are independent monomials, gauge invariant. These guys are there. So there are an F square of them. But if I count the Gaussian bosons, it doesn't work. So there is something else. Are there any other gauge invariant monomials that I can construct? Yes, there are. There are the baryons. In this case, that's very easy to realize. There is one B that essentially is the determinant. In this case, it's the determinant of Q. Now, Q is a square matrix now. So as a square matrix, I can write the determinant of Q. There is no way I can write this as a combination of these guys, because this guy has a QP unit. So determinant of Q is certainly an independent gauge invariant, holomorphic, that I could not have written. I could not have written. By the way, it's not a monomial in this case if you write it in the Q, it's the sum, but it doesn't matter. It's the independent piece, okay, which is gauge invariant. I could not have written it in this way. So certainly this guy is there, and that's one reason why the counting of the moduli space of the Gaussian boson goes wrong. There is, of course, another one, which is B tilde, which is the determinant of Q tilde. Okay? Now I got an F squared plus 1 plus 1. So the total counting now is, I have, it looks like the modular space, let's just look at the dimension. It looks like the dimension of the classical modular space for an F equal to NC, it looks like it is NC, NF squared plus 2. But I am overcounting. Does anybody see why? There is a relation between these guys. Classically, these are matrices. We will see that this is not so trivial in quantum theory, but classically, these are matrices. So certainly, if I take the determinant of this guy, I get the product of the determinants. So I'm overcounting, because there is a constraint, which is that the determinant of n is equal to bd tilde. So it is actually 1. Now it works. You can check. So there was this 1 left. How about, so let me do now the general case for an F larger than NC, classically. So the modular space for the NF less than NC is this. For an F larger or equal than NC, you can play and check yourself. I will always have the mesons. Now we're all grown ups, we forget all the, well, in this case, actually, it's probably better to put them in. And then I have the baryons. Now, even if, so, if NF is larger than NC, now I cannot take the determinant. But you see, the point of the determinant is that I could use the epsilon tensor. I mean, this determinant is the epsilon tensor of the color that makes an invariant. I can still use the epsilon tensor here and take a bunch of, I take NC Qs, I take NC Qs, and I'm almost done, let me just, and and this way, these guys will have some index, F1, F2, FNC, and I contract them with an epsilon tensor, which is the invariant tensor of SUNC. I want to make a gauge invariant, so this will be, right? So this clearly is a gauge invariant object, because SUNC has determinant 1, I hope you realize this is invariant. And this, so, if an F is equal to NC, this basically there's only one term that I can have, because all the Fs here have to be different. In general, however, this will be an antisymmetric, it will be an antisymmetric tensor in the NF space, right, which has NC component. This is in the NF space, so let's write SU and F. And these are baryons as well, but they will carry some indices F. So there will be a baryon, so there will be baryons with a bunch of Fs, baryon tilde with a bunch of Fs, tilde or prime, right? And there will be a constraint like this, but a little bit different. You can play with it, and, well, you can read it in my notes. It's the, by now it's just simple algebra. Let me just write it down. The constraints are the following. Let me just write them down. B with all the f's, that is B tilde with all the f primes, is equal to this is, I mean, the details are not terribly important at this point. I think we can call it a day. There is a constraint like that, and there is another constraint that says that anti-symmetrizing one more q will kill the whole business, and so b times m anti-symmetrized is zero, and exactly the same for b tilde. So these are generalized constraints to the ones that I displayed here in a little bit more details that just arise, you know, just play with it, it's just simple matrix algebra. These constraints themselves, these are the only constraints we have, these constraints themselves are actually redundant. So there is a constraint on the constraint. So it gets a little bit hysterical, but we will not go through it. You can actually check that everything works. And basically, the modular space, the classical modular space, for an f larger than or equal than c is parameterized by the good old mesons, which we have anyway, plus the values b and b tilde, which in the case where an f is equal to nc are just a complex field, and if an f is nc plus 1, there is an f here, if an f is nc plus 2, there is a 2 f's here, and they're antisymmetric, and so on, okay? Up to those constraints, okay? So this, sorry about going over time, this has solved, or at least has shown or argued about what is the solution to the classical modular space of super QCD in the case where there is no superpotential. The fun part begins next time, hopefully, where we look at the quantum corrections. So we will see that not only we can get the classical modular space, but we also can see how quantum mechanics changes this picture without really doing it. That's the amazing thing, without really doing any hard calculation. By using basically the properties that are required by holomorphicity, orthography, and gauge invariance, and supersymmetry, and all these things. So we do that tomorrow. No, not tomorrow. The day after tomorrow. Right. Come back.